Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Christmas Scarf Murder by Carlene O'Connor, narrated by Callie Beaulieu. Chapter 1. Siobhan O'Sullivan stood in the kitchen of her new stone farmhouse, leafing through holiday recipes and insisting yet again to her younger brother Kieran that Santa wasn't bringing him a tractor for Christmas, when her husband opened the front door and poked his head in. She grinned. Her husband. 6 months of marriage and it still didn't feel real. Cold air blasted in from the outside, but when Siobhan caught the worried expression on McDaughter's handsome face, she dropped all plans to scold him. "The Grinch paid a visit to the elder care home," he said. "The residents have all been robbed." "You're joking me." The Kilbane elder care home was small and exclusive, catering to wealthy clients. It was located outside of town in a beautiful Victorian-style house painted a cheerful yellow. They had immaculate gardens, and every year the grounds were decorated to the hilt for Christmas. Mechanical reindeer, Santa and his sleigh, and every tree on the property would be wrapped in colorful lights. It was so lavish it nearly made Siobhan wish she was old enough to move in. Siobhan had been looking forward to visiting this year, only she was worried her younger siblings Anne and Kieran would insist they decorate their new fields in the same over-the-top fashion. Although they certainly had the room, and Siobhan loved decorating for Christmas, she wanted something rustic and cozy. White lights and a gorgeous wreath for the door, maybe a candle or two in the window. And this year she wanted them to cut down a live Christmas tree. It was their first Christmas in their new house, and she wanted that Christmas tree smell. McDara's news was troubling indeed. Who would rob an elder care home a fortnight before Christmas? "The poor pets," Siobhan said. "Is everyone all right?"
"Thank goodness, no bodily harm to anyone, but I hear some very dear items have been taken and everyone is in quite the state."
"It's a frightening thing when you're robbed," Siobhan said. "They must feel so vulnerable." MacDara nodded.
"I know it's your day off, but nearly everyone is taking their holidays."
"Say no more, Detective Sergeant," Siobhan said. "I'll get me uniform on." MacDara nodded.
"I'll be out here, Garda O'Sullivan."
He leaned in for a kiss.
"You promised you'd stop doing that before brekkie," Kieran said. "I've lost me appetite. Again?"
They broke apart and laughed. "You already had two Irish breakfasts," Siobhan said.
"It's a good thing I horsed them into me before all the mushy stuff then, isn't it?"
Kieran responded. MacDara clapped Kieran on the back. Kieran shook his head.
"I deserve a tractor for this."
Siobhan wished she could bottle this moment, their first Christmas as husband and wife, as a family. The entire brood would fill the house to celebrate, even James, Grania, and Owen, Siobhan's siblings who were now independent and free, would camp out for the holidays. Her minor siblings, Anne and Kieran, seemed to be adjusting to living at the farmhouse and chuffed to the bits that they each had their own room. James, Grania, and Owen were still living above the bistro, with a lot more room to spread out. Was it only 7 months since they moved from above their former bistro in town to the farmhouse? The time had flown by. Siobhan's five siblings had lived with her ever since their parents had been killed by a drunk driver in a road accident 8 years prior. There were times she wanted to keep them with her forever. Luckily, Owen and James were building a farm-to-table restaurant on their new farm, and Grania was chomping at the bit to help decorate it. Siobhan saw them nearly every day. Family was everything. And yet change was inevitable. But this year, they would all be together. And to top it off, they had invited their friend Dr. Jean Brady, an esteemed state pathologist, to join them for Christmas dinner.
She had let it slip that she was taking the holidays off this year and had lamented not having a big family to share it with. Siobhan was thrilled when she accepted the invitation. She handed Kieran back his Christmas wish list. Tractor was the only item on it. "Better add to this," she said, "unless you want a toy tractor." Kieran shook his head. "Typical." His voice was so low now. Puberty well underway, and she still wanted to squeeze his cheeks until he howled. "Isn't it enough we get to decorate our very own tractor for the parade?" Siobhan asked. Before they'd moved outside of town, Siobhan was barely aware there was a Christmas tractor parade. James had grown close to some of the lads participating and had volunteered the rest of the O'Sullivans to decorate a tractor, most of them either a Massey Ferguson or a John Deere. They were due at Bill Casey's farm this weekend to map out a route and start decorating. "And not unless I get to drive it home after," Kieran said. "I could mow the field." He said mow the field, but she could see it now. Kieran O'Sullivan speeding down the road in a tractor, mowing everything in his path but the grass. Never. "There will be plenty to keep you busy when Owen breaks ground on the new restaurant," she said. "You'll forget all about tractors." Their property used to contain an old dairy barn, and although it had burned down as a result of arson, Owen was going to rebuild and open a farm-to-table restaurant. Luckily, the property was zoned for both home and business. Not that the O'Sullivans were turning into instant farmers. None of them had the experience for that. But Owen was already making connections with local farmers to source the needed ingredients, and in the spring they were sure to at least have a vegetable garden and chickens. It was crazy how swiftly one's life could change, and although somewhat dizzying, Siobhan was finding it an absolute thrill. "I'll never forget about tractors," Kieran said. "I was born to ride." "What about a hoverboard?" McDara asked. "Santi might be able to spring for one of those." Kieran shook his head. "What about a Vespa?" "No," Siobhan said. Kieran put his hands on his hips and lasered her with a look. He was nearly as tall as she was. "You have one? I'm an adult." Kieran threw his arms open. "Where am I going to ride a hoverboard? In the field?" Siobhan sighed. The truth was, they were probably eventually going to have to get a tractor. But it would be the family tractor and not teenage transportation. "You need new hobbies," Siobhan said. "Why don't you do some brainstorming to see what you fancy?" "I'd rather do some barnstorming," he said, "with my new tractor." Siobhan laughed. "No planes, tractors, motorcycles, cars or scooters." "Fine," Kieran said. "I'll take the hoverboard." Siobhan threw MacDara a look, and he was smart enough to grimace. "We'll have to see what Christmas morning brings. Why don't you get out our decorations while we're gone?" She went to pat Kieran on the head, but he ducked and she swiped air. It was starting to look like there was going to be more than one Grinch in Kilbane this year. As they pulled into the lovely manicured grounds for the elder care home, Siobhan found herself wishing it was under happier circumstances. The yellow Victorian house with blue trim popped against the green fields. Lush hedges and gardens created a virtual Eden that blossomed in the spring. But during the Christmas holidays, the grounds were transformed into a winter wonderland, complete with a snow machine. Everyone was hoping it would snow for real this year, although most likely it would not, and Siobhan had a feeling the snow machine would be on the ready. Lovely paths curved through the gardens, featuring sculptures, bird baths, and benches. A gardener stood near a hedge with clippers, shaping the first row into large candy canes. The residents were so lucky to live in such a magical place. The thought of anyone robbing them infused her with anger. Respect for one's elders was an ironclad principle for the O'Sullivans, something the young ones of today seemed to be sorely lacking. The house sat on a high elevation, with sweeping views of hills and valleys, topped off by the curves of the Ballyhora Mountains. Christmas decorating was full steam ahead, with large plastic bins lining the drive and in the gardens, overflowing with garland, lights, and bows. Despite the cold, residents stood outside in hefty robes and slippers, clutching mugs of tea or coffee, some with winter coats, others with just hats and scarves. The minute the pair exited the vehicle, they could hear the excited hum of voices. It seemed the break-in had infused the home with a bit of excitement. "The guards are here," an old man shouted, waving both his hands at them as if he was stranded on an island and they were circling above in a plane. Siobhan waved back. It was nice to feel appreciated. Soon they were surrounded by the elderly residents, all speaking at once. "They stole Oscar's cane. It was a lovely carved wood with a golden handle. And Nola's precious emeralds. Nola doesn't have precious emeralds. She's messing with us. I did so have emeralds, and they've been stolen. Maybe it was your grandson. He's always poking around. Wash that filthy mouth out with soap, you old grouch, you, or I'll do it for you. Don't forget Rory's money." A short man with black spectacles stepped forward, brown eyes blinking rapidly. He looked like an adorable little owl. €500 they took. All me Christmas shopping money. He held his hands, palms up, as he shrugged. "What am I going to do now? This may be me last Christmas and I have to buy gifts for all me grandkids." Siobhan's heart squeezed. "I'm so sorry. We promise ye we'll get to the bottom of this. Don't forget me scarf." A plump woman in a flowered bathrobe and a bulky winter coat shoved her mobile phone at them, forcing them to look at the screen. On it was a hideous red scarf with green shamrocks. "Beverly, Beverly, Beverly. Didn't you hear the lads warn you about that scarf?" an old man said. His winter coat was zipped up, but he was wearing pajamas and slippers. He pointed to a spot in the distance. Siobhan followed the trajectory to a birdbath where a pair of 20-somethings were standing, a lad and a Colleen. It was nice to see young people on the grounds. He turned back to the plump woman. "That scarf is too long. You could wrap a giraffe's neck with that yoke and still have bits hanging off him. Did they not warn you about long scarf syndrome?" "Bah, humbug," Beverly said. "It was a work of passion. You can't stop knitting when you're filled with passion." "Excuse me," a small voice next to Siobhan piped up. She turned to find a tiny older woman clasping her hands together. She was dressed in a lovely fawn coat and had a red bow pinned in her hair. Her lips were heavily lined in a matching red. "I'm missing me Virgin Mary statue. It isn't very dear, but my mammy bought it at the very first Christmas market in the town square, with money she'd been saving the whole year. It has great sentimental value. I can't bear the thought that it's gone." Siobhan placed her hand on the woman's shoulders. "What's your name, love?"
"Sinead."
"Sinead, your statue sounds most dear to me." Sinead nodded, her eyes filling with tears. "It makes me feel connected to her. It's like a piece of her." Siobhan nodded. She understood very well. They had items from her late parents that felt like an extension of them. "We'll treat your missing statue with the same value we do the missing emeralds." She turned to the crowd. "I promise ye we are going to do everything we can to sort this out." They all started talking at once. "Give us a minute to speak with the director," Siobhan said. "We'll soon have a proper sit-down with each one of you." The residents stopped jabbering and stared, their faces stamped with hope. Siobhan wondered if she should warn them that it's very rare to recover items in a robbery. The thieves could be long gone by now.
As they took a step toward the house, an exuberant border collie bounded their way, a small stuffed elf in his mouth. He dropped it at Siobhan's feet and looked up expectantly.
"Aren't you a wee dote?" she said.
"That's Max," the man with the black spectacles said. "He's visiting us for the holidays. Insanely intelligent, that dog."
"And adorable," Siobhan said, leaning down. "Who's a good boy?"
The dog, tongue hanging out, swung its head in MacDara's direction.
"Did you see that?" MacDara said. "He's smirking at me."
MacDara bent down to pick up the elf. The dog snatched it and laid it at Siobhan's feet.
"Cheeky dog," MacDara said. "He only wants you to throw it."
Siobhan picked up the elf. "Do you hear that, love?
Me husband is jealous of a dog."
"I think we might be looking at our thief right here," MacDara said, wagging his finger at the dog.
Siobhan laughed, then tossed the elf. The dog bounded after it. MacDara gave her a look.
"You're like a magical woodland creature," he said, "beloved by all your subjects."
She punched him in the arm. "Sort yourself out. Maybe you'll grow on him."
"Look at that complexion,"
a sweet old woman to her right said, reaching for Siobhan's face.
"Like a bowl full of cream."
"And that gorgeous red hair," another cooed. "You must have all the lads after you."
"And all the woodland creatures," MacDara repeated, ducking as Siobhan went in for another swipe.
Her hair was really auburn, but it was futile correcting people. Some saw the world in a variety of shades. Others couldn't be bothered. Siobhan didn't dare look at MacDara. She knew he was struggling to contain a cheeky response. She'd give it 24 hours before he made a bowl full of cream remark.
"What a handsome detective," a woman cooed at MacDara. "How can you catch criminals with that sweet face?"
Siobhan rather enjoyed watching his sweet face turn red and wondered if that made her a terrible person.
"They've designated a meeting room inside for our inquiries," MacDara said, clearing his throat and trying to regain a sense of order. "But first, we need to speak with the director."
"Are you going to take fingerprints?" Sinead said. "I've only seen it on Law and Order."
"It's highly likely that the thieves wore gloves," MacDara said politely.
"What a pity," she said, smacking her lips together. "I so wanted to see how you do it."
Sinead seemed to shrink with disappointment, her little red bow dipping lower and lower.
"I'll see what I can do," MacDara said. "It never hurts to arrange a little demonstration."
She grinned, stood on her tiptoes, and planted a kiss on MacDara's cheek. He turned red enough to make the lipstick marks blend in with the rest of his face.
"You can handcuff me too," she said. "I don't mind."
She held up her wrists for inspection. MacDara took out his mobile and walked a few feet away to make a call. He returned moments later with a satisfied grin on his face. Before Siobhan could ask him what that was all about, a middle-aged man in a gray suit was hurrying up the path toward them, his hand extended.
"I'm Cathal Ryan. You must be D.S. Flannery. We spoke on the phone."
He was a handsome man with salt-and-pepper hair feathered back and light blue eyes accentuated by his blue tie and pocket square.
"That would be me," MacDara said, "and this is Garda O'Sullivan, otherwise known as my wife," he said with a wink.
Siobhan groaned. Cathal raised an eyebrow.
6 months so far," Siobhan said.
"Congratulations."
He flashed perfectly straight and white teeth.
"So far?" MacDara said.
"Do tell us about the break-in," Siobhan said.
"Follow me," Cathal said.
They headed up the path toward the house and soon stepped onto the grand front porch. More bins were stacked, one on top of the other.
Some had their lids off, revealing a mountain of garland and lights. A pair of lads, also in their early 20s, stood nearby, listening to opposing decorating instructions from a nearby cluster of residents.
String 'em up along the roof.
No, not the roof, are you mad? String them along the windows. What about the portrait, lads? Do you think he can manage that?
Max, stuffed elf in his mouth, sat happily watching the hubbub.
Cahal nodded to the younger men. We have a small group of lads from the tractor parade helping us decorate this year.
Grand, Siobhan said.
She hated her next thought. It was cynical, but she had a job to do.
Could one of them be the thief?
There were four of them, a lad and a lass by the birdbath and two lads on the porch.
Were they good-hearted young people, giving their time to their elders at Christmas, or scheming thieves out to swindle them?
It was the nature of this job that one had to explore all possibilities.
Cahal pointed to the front door. It was made of oak, with a small stained-glass window and a lion knocker.
Siobhan loved it.
Isn't this gorgeous? She said to MacDara, pointing out the lion. Maybe Santi will bring me something similar.
Maybe you should be happy with your bowl full of cream, MacDara retorted. She gently punched his arm and he laughed. That hadn't taken long at all. Why hadn't she placed a bet with someone?
Potted holly bushes flanked the door and a pair of glass lamps were situated on either side. She could imagine how gorgeous it looked in the evening, with the flames dancing.
This is the main entrance, Cahal was saying. There were no signs of a break-in, per se.
When did the robbery occur? MacDara asked.
Residents only discovered their items missing this morning after breakfast, but we assume it took place yesterday when most of us were on an outing.
An outing? Siobhan asked. He nodded.
We helped decorate the town square for the Christmas market, he said. It was a grand day.
His grin soon faded, followed by a wretched morning.
Wait, Siobhan said. Why did you add per se?
Pardon?
You said there were no signs of a break-in per se.
Cahal nodded.
Yes, I'd rather show you once we go inside.
Did you have any items stolen? MacDara asked.
Cahal shook his head. I live off-site, and nothing in my office seems to be disturbed.
To be honest, I'm puzzled. Only five residents had items stolen, and coincidentally, they were the five residents that remained behind.
That didn't sound at all like a coincidence to Siobhan.
Their items were nicked yesterday, but you're only reporting it today?
I'm afraid it was chaos here last night, in a good way. There was the excitement of the residents who returned from the market showing off their wares, along with the items we shopped for, the five who remained behind, and then we had carolers pay us a visit. A few residents said they had been looking for their items, but misplacing things is a common occurrence around here. It wasn't until the next morning, when they started looking in earnest and comparing stories, that we realized this was more than just misplacing their things, that they had, indeed, been robbed.
Do these same residents usually stay behind? She asked.
As a matter of fact, they do, Cahal said.
Are you saying the thief knew that? That this was an inside job?
Anything is possible, MacDara said. We've a long ways to go before we make any declarations.
Perhaps he or she was interrupted before they could steal from anyone else, Siobhan said. But why start with the five residents who were still on the grounds?
That seemed very risky.
Was this a thief who thrived on the risk of being caught?
Downright nonsensical, if you ask me, Cahal said. The money and emeralds, if they exist, make sense all right, but He also steals a cane, a scarf, and a Virgin Mary statue? Who does that?
What makes you so sure the thief is a he?
Siobhan asked. Pardon me, Garda, he said. You're quite right. The thief may be a member of the fairer sex.
Inwardly, she groaned at the phrase, but she wasn't here to school others on their parts of speech.
How long was the outing to the Christmas market? McDara asked.
We were there for most of the day, Cahal said, from 10 a.m. to 4.
The town square hosted the Christmas market every year, attracting nearly the entire village. It was a grand place to find Christmas gifts, drink hot cocoa, and sample desserts. It was also where the yearly Christmas pantomime was held. Every year, the pantomime was based on a fairy tale and given a comedic twist. The panto, as everyone called it, was a cherished tradition. Siobhan's own brood had starred in one a few years back, a hearty rendition of Jack and the Beanstalk.
All but the 5 residents who had items stolen attended the outing? Siobhan asked.
That is correct, Cahal said. Our front office manager, Nancy Martin, remained on site as well.
And what about our 4 young volunteers? Siobhan asked. Where were they?
They accompanied us on the outing as well, Cahal said, although I did not have eyes on them the entire time. They're young, they come and go as they please.
And no one saw any strangers on the property? McDara asked. Or did anyone hear anything odd?
Cahal sighed. Unfortunately, aside from the one room in the house I need to show you, no one reported hearing or seeing a single thing out of the ordinary. It was as if we were robbed by a Christmas mouse.
More like a Christmas rat, McTara said.
One of the young lads approached. He had a mop of blonde curls and intense blue eyes. He wagged his finger at them.
If you wanted someone to blame, look no further than the house manager, Nancy Martin.
Chapter 2. Cahal stepped toward the young man, a look of panic stamped on his face.
Blame Nancy Martin? Whatever do you mean?
I was at the Christmas market but returned early, the young man said. None of them heard a thing because Nancy was blasting Christmas songs.
He glanced at Siobhan and McDara. Nancy is a mad one for the Christmas music.
He grinned, stuck out his hand. I'm Finn Doyle, Nola's grandson.
Cahal leaned in. Nola is the resident who claims she's missing precious emeralds. Finn's face clouded over.
If my granny says her emeralds were stolen, then her emeralds were stolen.
Of course.
Of course, Cahal said. It's just, none of us have ever seen these emeralds.
I've seen them, Finn said. We were just arranging to have them valuated.
Then why hasn't she shown them to anyone else? Cahal asked.
Because they're too valuable to flash around.
Finn tapped his forehead with his index finger. He turned to McDara.
That's why she kept them in her safe. And now, they're gone.
Cahal turned to Siobhan and McDara.
He's right about one thing. Nancy does like to blast her Christmas tunes.
Who doesn't?
Siobhan said. She loved everything about Christmas.
How many residents and staff do you have in total?
McDara asked.
We only have 12 residents at a time, Cahal said. Our waiting list is very long.
McDara leaned into Siobhan's ear. Should we put her names in now?
Definitely yours, she said. His chuckle warmed her insides.
As far as staff goes, we have myself and Nancy, the kitchen staff and housekeeping.
He began to count on his fingers.
15 of us in all.
15,
McDara said. That was a lot of suspects.
But many are on their Christmas break, Cahal said. Leaving tree kitchen staff and tree housekeepers.
That certainly helped.
We're lucky to still have Nancy.
He leaned in and lowered his voice. Her husband is running for mayor of Cork in the spring.
Isn't that exciting?
Siobhan didn't get particularly excited about politics and was trying to come up with a polite response when they were interrupted.
Don't plug it in yet!
They turned to see a red-faced old man berating a young lad with red hair and spiked fringes. He jumped at the reprimand, jostling the string of Christmas lights in his arms. He wrapped the string around his neck and mimicked hanging himself. Max barked and began tugging on the Christmas lights.
I'm only messing, Max,
the red-headed lad said. Let go! The dog immediately let go.
Good boy!
He removed a treat from his pocket and the dog snatched it up.
Quit horsing around, the old man yelled. Do you think this roof is going to decorate itself? I'm not deaf.
The young man removed the string of lights from his neck. He towered over the old man.
You don't have to shout.
Ease up,
MacDara said. The young man shot a withering look at the detective sergeant, but took a step back. Cahal, eager to move on, pointed once more to the ornate front door.
As I've mentioned, there were no signs of a break-in at our front or our back doors. They are the only two means of entry.
Except for the roof.
The comment came from another young lad stepping onto the porch. His head was shaved, but he had a baby face and fawn brown eyes.
Down the chimney, he added. Santy and his sleigh?
Shall I introduce you to our helpers? Cahal said.
It makes us sound like elves, the one with the shaved head said with a laugh.
No one would ever mistake you for an elf, Shane Boyd, Cahal said. And that's your introduction sorted?
He pointed to the redhead, Michael Walsh. Still holding the lights, Walsh bowed. Max barked, then dipped down. MacDara pointed at the dog.
Did he just bow?
He's fierce intelligent, Michael said. Meet my wonder dog, Max.
And I'm Bonnie Murphy.
The one female of the group of young ones stepped onto the porch. She had gorgeous black hair cascading down her back in waves. She was probably 6 years younger than Siobhan. Bonnie flashed a million-dollar smile at MacDara, and he blushed. Siobhan cocked her head, mostly surprised at the ripple of jealousy that went through her. MacDara turned to Cahal.
Is there no security system on the grounds?
He glanced at the dog.
He's not a guard dog, Michael said. But I do believe he would have barked if he sensed a criminal around.
He paused.
Unless they had biscuits. Then I'm afraid he would have let the Grinch himself rob everyone blind.
He winked. Thanks for the tip, Siobhan said. She would have to buy some for Trigger, their Jack Russell Terrier. He could use a little training.
Right, so,
Finn said, looping his arm around Michael Walsh and nodding to Shane and Bonnie.
It's off to Casey's with us.
Bill Casey?
Siobhan asked. He was the farmer hosting the tractor parade. Her brood would be there as well. Had they not been interrupted by this theft, she would have been there herself.
Aye, Finn said. The four of us are going to have the best-dressed tractor in Kilbane,
Max barked.
Make that the five of us,
Finn said, ruffling the dog's head.
Isn't that right, Max?
Max barked enthusiastically and everyone laughed. The foursome bounded off the porch, whooping and singing as they headed off the grounds. Max trotted along behind them.
Ugh, to be young again,
the old man on the porch said as he watched them go. Cahal removed his pocket square and dabbed around his mouth as if trying to prevent the wrong words from coming out.
Back to the security system, he said. Someone shut down the main panel.
He gestured for them to come closer, then opened the front door and ushered them in. The first thing that struck Siobhan when she stepped inside was that it really did look like a proper home. The floors matched the lovely dark wood in the front door, as well as the moldings and the rails of a curved stairway just past the foyer. Parlor doors flanked the left and the right sides, and both were thrown open. A cozy sitting room was situated to their right, and a grand library with a crackling fireplace to the left. A pair of binoculars sat on a coffee table in the library room. Siobhan could imagine how lovely it would be to sit by a cozy fire and gaze out the large windows with the binoculars. She was starting to think the golden years were the ones for her. Cardboard boxes were stacked everywhere you looked. Writing in thick black marker gave away their contents. Xmas decorations. Cahal closed the door and pointed to an electronic panel on the wall. Yesterday morning, before we left for the market, this security panel was working fine. When the thefts were reported, I ran to check it and it was turned off. As you can see, it's back on now, but the security company confirmed that it was off for 24 hours. How many people know the security code? MacDara asked. All of the employees. Cahal bowed his head. I know you'll have to investigate everyone, but in my opinion, not a single one of my employees would ever be involved in something so heinous. What about the windows? MacDara said, stepping into the library and approaching the panes. Do they open from the outside? He gave a little tug. They did not open. We seal them shut in the winter, Cahal said. Otherwise it gets too drafty. MacDara nodded. Is it possible our thief had a key to the house? Siobhan wandered over to the table and picked up the binoculars. Heavy curtains obscured most of the windows, so she put them down again. She turned and stared across the way at the security panel. Had this been an inside job? Cahal chewed on his lip. I'm afraid it is possible. We usually change the locks after a resident leaves, but it's been a very chaotic year with a lot of changeover, and I've been waiting for a locksmith. Everyone is busy these days. It's taken forever. As soon as we're done having a nose about, I'll call a locksmith for you, MacDara said. If you didn't need the locks changed then, you certainly do now. He stepped closer to the front door and carefully examined the edges and the lock. No signs of distress, he turned to Cahal. What is the usual procedure for visitors to gain entrance? You ring the bell, Cahal said, stepping back onto the porch and pointing to a buzzer to the right. One of the staff will greet you and sign you in. Were there any visitors during the break-in? I'm afraid you'll have to check with Nancy. She keeps a visitor log. What about other types of visitors? Siobhan asked. Delivery men and the like? They're not required to sign in, Cahal said. But we do have a security camera. He dropped his hand. Unfortunately, it only works if the panel is powered on, and I've already mentioned someone had turned it off. We'll need to look at your visitor log for the entire week leading up to the theft, MacDara said as they all stepped back inside. Cahal nodded. As I said, Nancy Martin keeps track of all that. Guards are on their way to dust for fingerprints, MacDara said. Let's make sure that lovely lady with the red bow gets a demonstration. That Sinead, Cahal said with a nod and a smile. Siobhan looped her arm through MacDara's. That is very given of you, Santy, she whispered. He winked. You can thank me later, Mrs. Claus. She gently pushed him off. I'm way too young to be Mrs. Claus. Cahal glanced at his watch as if wondering how long all this banter was going to take. Siobhan stepped away from MacDara and straightened her spine. Shall I show you why I said that nothing had been disturbed per se? Cahal asked. He headed down the hall and they followed. He passed a grand kitchen filled with people in white aprons rolling out dough. The scent of sugar wafted out. "They're making Christmas biscuits," he said, "to die for." A few of the bakers waved, and Siobhan waved back. A woman pushing a cleaning cart blocked their path. Her dark hair was ensconced in a white headband, salt and pepper tendrils spilling out of it. "Christmas biscuits! Bah humbug!" She thrust her index finger into the air. "Did you not hear me say that ever since this Christmas biscuit craze started up, I've seen ants in the residence rooms?" she said. "Ants!" "The residents know not to eat in their rooms, Mrs. Grady," Cahal said. The woman shook her head. "Well, they're still doing it. I found ants in several rooms, carrying crumbs back to their queen." "It is Christmas," MacDara quipped. "Even the ants are getting into this spirit." Mrs. Grady gave him a withering look. "Horrible," he said. "Ants are a horrible, horrible nuisance." She nodded and let out a puff of air, disturbing a tendril of hair, making it fly up. "They certainly are." "I'll have another word with the residents," Cahal said.
"You do that," she said. "I'm a housekeeper, not an exterminator."
She shoved the cart forward, muttering as she left. "Here we are," Cahal said, stopping at the last room on the floor. "This is the recreational room, the main place where our residents come to relax, play games, watch telly." It was a generous room, with plush sofas, a large television mounted to the wall, comfy chairs and tables, but they were all pushed back against the walls, leaving the middle wide open. "This is why I said per se. When we left for the market, this room was set up as per normal. Nothing was pushed against the walls. At first I thought it was Mrs. Grady, that she wanted to vacuum the center of the room. Although I thought it was quite puzzling, I couldn't imagine her moving all this furniture on her own. And when I brought her to the room to show her, she was furious. She insists she didn't leave it like this, and I believe her." It was very odd indeed. What kind of thief would take time out to shove all the furniture to the back of a room? "It's befuddling," Cahal said. "We leave for a few hours to do some Christmas shopping and the whole place goes mad." They returned to the foyer. Cahal pointed to the formal sitting room on the right. "I'll go find Nancy. Please, have a seat." Siobhan and MacDara waited in the sitting room, listening to the sound of the cuckoo clock ticking precious minutes away. It felt like an eternity before they heard the sound of heels clacking on the floorboards. Moments later, a smiling woman with chestnut hair and a flowery dress appeared. "I'm Nancy Martin," she said, extending her hand as Siobhan and MacDara stood. "Welcome to the Kilbane Elder Care Home." She was a beautiful woman, with light brown eyes and a generous smile. They shook hands and introduced themselves. Cahal Ryan popped up behind her. His hair was mussed up and there was red lipstick next to his mouth. MacDara and Siobhan exchanged a quick look, then composed themselves. Were the two having an illicit work affair? Nancy gestured for them to sit again. "Shall we?" The moment they sat, a young woman in an apron and a sunny grin entered with a golden tray. On it perched two cups of tea and a generous plate of Christmas biscuits. She set them on the coffee table. Sugar cookies with colorful icing, they were in adorable shapes. Trees, Santa and reindeer.
"That's so kind of you," Siobhan said. "You shouldn't have."
MacDara already had half a Santa stuffed in his gob. He finished two more before the group of five came in, insisting it would be rude not to sample one of each. Introductions were formally made. Nola, Rory, Beverly, and Sinead. Oscar, the man who looked like an adorable owl, was the last to enter,
slamming his walker down with each step. "I want my cane," he spit out the words, accentuating it with a thunk of the walker hitting the floor. It was from my pilgrimage in Spain. It was a gorgeous dark wood with a golden head. "When you find the thieves and our stolen property, I'm going to take my cane and beat them over the head with it."
"There's no need for any of you to take matters into your own hands," Nancy said. "The guards are here to sort that all out." Cahal patted the pockets of his blazer.
"My keys," he said. "Has anyone seen my keys?"
"I completely forgot," Nancy said. "The morning chef mentioned finding a set of keys in the kitchen this morning."
"I'll go speak with him,"
Nancy grimaced. "I'm afraid he's gone for the day."
"What?"
Cahal's voice flashed with anger. "Where did he leave my keys?" "I can't say for sure they were yours," Nancy said. "I didn't get a good look at them." Cahal raised an eyebrow.
"Who else is missing keys?"
"You're right, of course," Nancy said. "They must be yours. Everything happened so quickly. The chef mentioned the keys, and then one by one residents discovered their items missing. I completely forgot. I'm sorry."
Cahal straightened up, and he seemed to be wrestling with his response. "You'll have to be a bit more organized when you're the mayor's wife," he said with a wry smile.
Nancy frowned for a moment and then laughed. "Don't tell me, husband. He's a nervous wreck as it is."
"Do your missing keys include your car keys?" Siobhan asked.
"Yes," Cahal said.
"Why do you ask?"
MacDara nudged forward.
"Where do you park your car?"
Cahal's eyes widened.
"Are you saying my car might have been stolen? A getaway car?"
"Did you drive it to the market this morning?"
MacDara asked.
Cahal shook his head.
"No, we had a rental bus."
"Let's see if we can find the keys first," Nancy said. "Then look for your car."
"I'll check with the kitchen staff," Cahal said.
"I'll help." Nancy turned to Siobhan and MacDara. "You'll be all right on your own?"
"They've got us," Beverly said. "What do you think we're going to do? Bite them?"
Oscar eyed the dwindling plate of biscuits.
"Are you sure they're here to help?" he asked.
MacDara slouched in his chair. Siobhan knew he'd been poised to go in for a fourth. Nancy and Cahal exited the room and the residents began to gab, and gab, and gab, and gab. She glanced at the clock on the wall. Nearly an hour and a half had passed, and although Siobhan and MacDara's heads were now filled with stories of their children and grandchildren and days of yore, they were getting nowhere. She assumed Cahal had found his keys and his car, for he had completely disappeared. She felt for these folks. They were dying for a bit of company, and this was an exciting day. But she was itching to get out of here. Perhaps she wasn't quite ready for her golden years after all.
"It's been lovely chatting," Siobhan said, "but we must focus on the case now."
"Absolutely,"
MacDara said. The relief in his voice was palpable. He too had been having a hard time cutting them off and getting the residents to focus, and the plate of cookies had been reduced to crumbs.
"I don't know what you're doing here,"
Nola said to Beverly. Siobhan recognized Beverly as the plump woman in the flowery housecoat, the one who had shown them the photo of the uber-long scarf.
"All you had stolen was an ugly scarf,"
Beverly gasped.
"It was not ugly. It was handmade."
Nola rolled her eyes.
"Obviously the thief didn't think it was ugly now, did he?"
Before Siobhan and MacDara could put a stop to it, four residents were once again yelling over top of each other. Sinead sat quietly, working her rosary beads. Suddenly, "Silent Night" blared through the room. Ironic. All heads turned to Nancy, who was planted next to the stereo. When she had their attention, she turned the volume down. "Now,"
she said. You're behaving like spoiled children. The guards need to file their report, and they don't have all day. Apologies went around the room. Did you find Cahal's keys? Siobhan asked. Nancy nodded. The housekeeper had them.
And his car?
MacDara said. Safe and sound. That was a relief. But Nancy and Cahal had been gone an awfully long time. Siobhan was starting to wonder if the missing keys was a ruse, an excuse to be alone. It was risky to get romantically involved with work partners. Then again, given she and MacDara worked together, she was one to talk. However, Nancy was married. To a possible future mayor, no less. An affair wouldn't just be messy. It would be reckless. Hopefully there was nothing going on between her and Cahal. It was the nature of her job that made Siobhan suspicious of everything. She had to be careful not to jump to conclusions. We just need each of you to write down the items that were stolen from you and anything else you can remember from the time of the theft.
You want us to write all of that?
Oscar held up a gnarled hand. We can write it for you, Siobhan said. We'll be setting up individual interviews. From somewhere in the room, a phone rang, making them all jump. It was Nancy's. She moved into the foyer as she answered. Siobhan could still hear her talking. Yes? Who? Oh, yes. Yes, they're still here. What? My word. When Nancy returned to the room, her face was a portrait of a woman about to panic. That was Bill Casey, MacDara stood.
From the tractor parade?
Nancy nodded. The tractors were on a dry run for the parade, and there's been a terrible, terrible accident. Chapter 3. It was not something they saw every day. An entire country road lined with tractors in all shapes, sizes, and colors at a complete standstill. A few sported the beginnings of Christmas decorations, lights, bows, and garland, but most of them had not yet been adorned. There were 20 tractors in all. The tragedy became evident when they reached the fifth tractor in line, a green and yellow John Deere. A man was lying on the road directly behind the tractor. Lying on his back, his head was tilted at an unnatural angle. A red scarf with green shamrocks was wound around his neck, the end disappearing into the wheel well. Witnesses had said he'd been lifted off the tractor and slammed down onto the road. The scarf must have become entangled with the wheel. The victim had spiky red hair.
It's Michael Walsh,
MacDara said. Michael Walsh? Siobhan repeated. Sorrow gripped her as she stared at his red fringe. No matter how many times she'd seen death, it always jarred her. Just hours ago, this lad had been on the front porch of the elder care home, messing around with his friends and introducing them to his dog. Siobhan edged forward and stared at the scarf as a refrain ran through her mind. Long scarf syndrome. She recognized the scarf immediately. Long enough for a giraffe, as hideous in person as it was in the photo. It's Beverly's stolen scarf, she said. MacDara stared at the scarf, then at their victim.
Do you think he's our thief?
I don't know. Why would he flaunt the stolen scarf when he knows we're on the case?
Perhaps he liked the danger, MacDara said, or he had little faith in our detecting skills.
We'll find out soon enough. At least Jeannie is in town. They'd already placed a call to Dr. Brady, and she was on her way. A burly man approached, covered in layers of flannel, sporting a tweed cap and handlebar mustache. His eyes were red, Andy was still trying to wipe tears off his face with the back of his hand. When he composed himself, he wiped his hand on his trousers and stuck it out. "I'm Bill Casey." MacDara shook hands and introduced them. "Mr. Casey," Siobhan said, "you're the host of this year's tractor parade."
"Call me Bill."
"Indeed, Garda. And before you begin your investigation, there's something you need to know."
"Go on,"
MacDara said.
"He wasn't wearing that scarf this morning, or when we started on the route."
"You mean he put it on during the ride?" Siobhan asked.
"I don't see where he would have put it," Bill said. "You can see his coat isn't that bulky."
They all looked down at his coat. He was right. It was a mere jacket.
"You're sure he didn't have it tucked inside and you just didn't notice?"
MacDara asked. Bill shook his head.
"I've been doing this tractor run for years. I always warn them about any loose bits of clothing, especially scarves. I definitely would have noticed."
"What are you saying?" Siobhan asked. "He obviously had the scarf stashed somewhere." Bill Casey nodded.
"That's the other troubling bit of the story. We'd just begun the practice route when a blue Toyota came flying past, driving on the field. They screeched to a halt in front of your man here."
He gestured to the victim. The driver exited the vehicle and others could see them head to head having a chat. After a minute, the driver got back into the car. It was after that your man was wearing the scarf. The car screeched away and your one here started his tractor and then... He slapped his hand over his eye. "I'm lucky I was in the front and didn't have to see it. The ones who were directly behind him are in shock. The minute he moved the tractor forward, he was yanked out of his seat, flipped into the air, and landed behind the tractor. The only saving grace is that he went quick." Siobhan crossed herself. "Was it a man or a woman who got out of the car?"
"That's another odd thing," Mr. Casey said. "We don't know."
"Pardon?" Siobhan tilted her head.
"The person was dressed in costume. I thought it was one of the panto actors. But usually those costumes are colorful fairy tale creatures and whatnot.
This person was head to toe in a long brown robe, like a monk. His or her face was completely obscured by a brown hood."
"Tall or short?" MacDara said.
"Medium," Casey said. "Or was he short?"
"I don't know. I didn't see him myself. The fella behind Michael just said he saw a brown hooded robe. It happened so fast."
This person got out of the car, approached our victim, and chatted for a moment? Siobhan asked. She was trying to picture it.
Casey nodded. "And we believe this pretend monk placed the scarf around his neck."
"Michael Walsh must have known the person. If a total stranger tried to place a long, ugly scarf around her neck, she certainly wouldn't have worn it. And Michael Walsh knew all about Beverly's stolen scarf. She'd been showing pictures of it to anyone who would look. Why on earth would he flaunt it in the tractor parade?" Siobhan turned to MacDara. "Did you hear one of the residents say something this morning about long scarf syndrome?"
"I certainly did," MacDara said. "And I know you do not like coincidences."
"I do not like coincidences," Siobhan confirmed. "Not a bit."
"I'm lost," Bill Casey said.
"This scarf was made by a resident of the Kilbane Elder Care Home," MacDara said. "It was reported as stolen." "Everyone was talking about how long and dangerous it was," Siobhan said. Bill Casey shuddered.
"It's bad enough if this was a terrible accident. But if it was deliberate?"
He shook his head.
"Who would do such a thing? A fortnight before Christmas."
Siobhan and MacDara remained silent. It was a question that had a depressing answer. Nearly everyone,
given the right circumstances, was capable of doing such a horrible thing.
We'll need to talk to the drivers of the tractor directly behind and in front of Michael Walsh to see exactly what they observed, MacDara said.
Casey nodded, then pointed to a cluster of folks up ahead in the field.
They're all there. Everyone is in shock.
I'd never met Michael Walsh before this morning, MacDara said. Was he new in town?
Visiting from Monaghan, I believe,
Bill said. Shane Boyd and Finn Doyle invited him.
Were they friends? Siobhan asked.
Bill shook his head.
I asked the group to nominate someone as our special guest this year. Every year we have a guest tractor for the parade. They read about his wonder dog Max in the local paper and contacted him. He seemed thrilled with the idea. And that dog is something else.
Where is the dog? Siobhan asked.
He's riding in my tractor at the head of the parade, Bill said. I have an enclosed cab. We felt it was the safest place for him.
He bowed his head.
A dog that smart? He's going to know his owner is gone.
They paused for a moment of silence. Shane and Finn. All three of them had been at the elder care home. Did this have anything to do with the theft? Were the three unwise men in it together? Had this murder been a long time in the making? Why would they want him dead? Was he threatening to tell on the others or trying to claim a bigger share of the stolen goods?
To tell you the truth, I should have told him he couldn't participate, Bill said. I should have trusted my gut.
MacDara edged forward.
What did your gut say?
Michael took the tractor for a joyride yesterday and ran over my neighbor's hedges. My neighbor was livid.
Bill shook his head.
He was a bit too cheeky and impulsive.
I should have disqualified him.
What is the name of this neighbor? MacDara asked.
Casey looked startled.
I don't think he wants his name dragged into this mess.
I'm afraid he won't have a choice in the matter, MacDara said.
Cahal Ryan, Bill said.
The elder home director, Siobhan asked.
The one in the same, Casey said.
Odd. He didn't mention it, and we were standing on the same porch with Michael.
I'm telling ye, he was quite livid. He threatened the lad.
Casey looked stricken.
I don't mean he threatened to do anything like this. He just warned him that if he did it again, he'd answer for it. Michael enjoyed trouble. You could see it in his eyes.
He stopped, then shook his head.
I'm not saying he deserved it. He was just a young lad with a troubled past. He could have sorted himself out. 'Tis a terrible, terrible day.
A troubled past? MacDara asked.
Bill nodded. Apparently he'd been released from jail a year prior.
Jail? MacDara said.
Some trouble after a breakup. A bit of stalking, I believe, Casey said. The type of lad that when he becomes fixated on something or someone, he just can't let go. At least that's what I heard.
Hold on, MacDara said. With that kind of past, he was allowed to volunteer the elder care home and be a special guest of your parade?
I swear to ye, I had no idea he was volunteering at the elder care home, Bill said.
But even so, he was supposed to have turned over a new leaf. There was a whole article on him in the newspaper. The jail he was in paired lads with homeless dogs so they could rehabilitate each other, like.
Your one's dog turned out to be brilliant. Walsh was featured for teaching the dog over 1,000 words. Can you believe that?
1,000, Siobhan said. She turned to MacDara. How many words do you think Trigger knows?
MacDara gave her a look and turned his attention back to Bill Casey.
Listen, he said. We have to cordon off this scene.
I want the tractor in front of Michael's and behind Michael's to remain where they are, but we'll need the other tractors to disperse. The ones in the front should continue straight ahead, and the ones in the back should turn and exit in the other direction, even if they have to take the long way back to your farm. Does this mean the tractor parade is off? Bill looked sheepish, but there was concern in his voice. All the money we collect goes to local charities. It's been a tough year for a lot of folks, and they're really counting on us. Let's take it one step at a time, Siobhan said. Such terrible business, Bill said. I don't know how I'm going to break the news to his family. They had such high hopes that he was really turning his life around. We'll contact his family, Siobhan said, but I'm sure they'll need and appreciate your support. And we're going to need everyone to write down their account to the car that stopped, McDara said. Any detail, no matter how small. Absolutely. We'll go back to the farm and do it. There are no CCTV cameras in this area, McDara continued, but check to see if anyone...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.